When it comes to recruiting at McKinsey, Bain, or BCG, there are two types of candidates. Those who know how to use opposite words to smartly structure their cases, and those who don't. Hey, my name is Bruno. I'm an ex-McKinsey consultant and the co-founder of Crafting Cases, where we teach you how to stand out in your case interviews by thinking like a top management consultant. And in this video, I'm gonna show you the fifth and final way to be missy, opposite words. Now, this video is part of a broader series called The 5 Ways to be Missy. So if you haven't watched the first video in the series, go back and watch that first. Now, let's jump right into opposite words. You've all used opposite words to structure your problems. So maybe the economy of a country is down, and that could be because of internal or external factors. Or you're trying to figure out why oil prices have risen, which could be an excess of demand or a constraint in supply. Or maybe you're trying to figure out why your competitor has bought another competitor, which could be for financial or non-financial reasons. These are some examples of using opposite words to structure a problem. And you can actually create opposite words for any problem and structure these problems with them. Opposite words are super powerful because they're quick, they're easy to create, and they're always missy and applicable to any problem. So you might be thinking, what's the catch? Well, on one hand, opposite words are easy to create and widely applicable. But on the other hand, they're never insightful and you'll never impress anyone by using them. Think of them as a wild card. You can use them to win the game, but it almost feels like cheating. So there are three situations where you will want to use opposite words. The first one is to separate inherently different problems. The second situation is to make your structures better by adding a layer of depth to them. And the third situation is to quickly organize your speech so that you sound like a more structured candidate so that your communication sounds more structured. Let's tackle each one of them individually. So the first situation to use these types of structures is actually the most useful one for it. So suppose your client has lost market share and they want to understand why. It could be that their demand for their products has dropped more than the overall market, or that they're not growing as fast as the overall market. But it could also be that demand is large, it's growing fast, however, they don't have the production capacity or the inventory to sell to that demand. So it could be a demand problem or a supply problem. And these two problems are inherently different. If people are not trying to buy your product or they don't want to buy your product, that's a different product than if you can't sell because you can't produce or you don't have inventory. So when the problems are inherently different, when you have two opposite problems that could be true and they're inherently different, you should use opposite words. That's probably the best type of structure you can come up with because it's really insightful. You're showing two problems of opposite nature, both of which are possible, and you want to understand which one of them is happening. The second situation where you will want to use opposite words is to add an extra layer to your structure. Now, adding an extra layer is good because it's going to make you sound more structured to your interviewer, but also because it's going to help you solve the problem more easily. Let me show you a couple of examples of that. To show you how you can use opposite words to create an extra layer in your structures, I'm going to get two cases that we've structured in previous videos of the 5 Ways to be Missy series using other types of structures, and then I'm going to show you how to create this extra layer using opposite words. So the first case is, why have TV ad revenues dropped in the last decade? And the structure we've used, this one comes from the algebra structure video, I think. I've broken down TV ad revenues using an algebra structure as the number of people who watch TV that might have dropped, times the average minutes watched per person that might have dropped, times the ad revenue per minute of TV watched. Now, this is the algebra structure, but we can create an extra layer using opposite words. So we can break down average minutes watched per person. This may have dropped due to substitution to other long-form video formats, so substitution from Netflix or YouTube or Vimeo or anything like that. Or it may have dropped despite no substitution to other long-form video formats. So maybe people are watching less TV because they're watching short video formats, so Snapchat, Instagram stories, which is despite no substitution because it's a different format. Or maybe they're doing other things. I don't know. They're studying more. They're reading books or hanging out with their families. I don't know. We can also break down ad revenue per minute of TV watched. May have dropped due to an increase in supply of ad slots or due to a decrease in demand for ad slots. So maybe there are more channels now, so there's more supply of ad slots, or maybe the demand has decreased indeed. So it's pretty easy to do that. Let me show you another example. This one comes from the conceptual structures video. What are possible reasons for an espresso's market share drop in the London's coffee capsules market? Actually, this comes from the video on the 5 ways to be messy, the main video, the first one in this playlist, and it's the conceptual framework example. So maybe market share for London's Nespresso's capsules has dropped because our customers have changed, because our competitors have changed, or because we have changed. Now, not very insightful, just a typical 3C structure. We can make it a little better by adding an extra layers with opposite words. Here's how. Our customers may have changed due to economic factors or due to non-economic factors. Now, not a lot of insight, it's just two opposite words. But you can have economic hypothesis and non-economic hypothesis. Our competitors may have changed because they've changed their operations or because they've changed their strategy. And we might have changed because our products have changed. Nespresso is a really product-oriented business, or because how we get those products to market has changed. So you can always make your structures a little deeper by using opposite words to create an extra layer. I think this is really good practice because you come across as a more structured candidate, you make your structures a little bit more insightful, and there's no downside because it's so quick and easy to create these opposite words to enhance each part of your structure that I think the benefits usually outweigh the risks or the costs. And the third way to use opposite words, or the third appropriate way to use opposite words, is when you're using it to structure your speech, to organize your speech. So say your interviewer comes to you and they ask you why you switched jobs. You might want to talk about the short-term reasons for that and the long-term reasons for that. Or if they ask you, what do you think or how do you feel about traveling a lot as a consultant? You can talk about the pros and the cons. Now, this is really simple, but by doing that, it's a powerful way to show your interviewer that you're structured even when you're not formally solving problems. So you can use opposite words to organize your speech while you're solving the case, but also during the fit portion of your interview, or even when you're getting coffee with a consultant or talking to them via phone. This shows you communicate like they do. Now, a couple of things to be aware of when using opposite words. The first thing you should be aware of is that they should never be the core of your structure. So say you get a problem and you divide it into supply and demand. And then on the supply side, you divide by internal and external factors. And on the demand side, you divide by economic and non-economic factors. Now, if you keep doing that, soon you have a large, messy structure that is empty in insight. So you can use opposite words to make your structures deeper So as an extra layer at the end that makes it more organized, that brings a little bit of insight, and you can use it to divide the problem into two different problems. So even supply and demand can be useful in some cases at the beginning of the case. But after that, after dividing the problem, you're gonna have to use a structure that brings more insight. So one of the three core structuring techniques to structure the supply problem, and one of the three core structuring techniques to fix the demand problem, or a mixture of those techniques. You can use a full issue tree or whatever. But the point is, if you're only using opposite words, you can build a huge structure that is messy, but it's gonna be empty in insight. So use them to divide the problem if you must, but then use one of the core structuring techniques to be more insightful when solving those problems. The second thing to be aware of when using an opposite word technique to structure your problems is that overusing them will make you sound robotic. Now, that doesn't mean you should avoid using them. Consultants use them. They use this technique all the time. So what's the balance? How do you know if you're overusing it or not? It's a little bit of feeling, but you know those people that they've heard that you're supposed to say a person's name during conversation so that they connect better with you, so that they like you more. You've probably heard of that. You know, use the person's name in conversation when talking to them for them to like you more. Now, some people hear this advice, and when they talk to you, they will be saying your name every 15 or 20 seconds. You've probably been in that situation. And soon you find yourself feeling like you're feeling uncomfortable. You're feeling like you're talking to a slimy salesperson. And the problem is not that they're saying your name. Saying your name is fine. The problem is that you notice that they're saying your name, they're overusing your name on purpose, not because they want to say your name, but because they feel like they must say your name. And that's the balance. You can use opposite words. You can use opposite words a lot. You can use them 5, 6, 7 times during a case. But use them when they're supposed to be used at. If you're just using opposite words because you feel like you have to use them, then you're gonna sound a bit like a robot. Just like the person who says your name every 20 seconds makes you feel like you're talking to a very bad salesperson. So this is how you use opposite words, the fifth way to be messy. Now in the next video, I'm gonna show you how to create issue trees from scratch by tying up the 5 ways to be messy. Now, issue trees are important because they're an essential part of the consulting job, and also as a candidate, they're one of the 3 things that you have to master in order to master the framework building block, in order to master how to start your case and how to build your initial structure. Now, any good consultant, any management consultant from these top firms can easily do an issue tree for any type of problem and very quickly, and so should you as a candidate. Because if you want to get an offer from these firms, you need to show them that you can actually think like a management consultant. So anything that they can do easily and that they do day to day is something that you should be able to do in your interviews. So stay tuned for the next video on how to create issue trees from scratch. You're not gonna find this anywhere else. So watch that video and tell me what you think about it. So if you've liked this video, hit like and click subscribe here. Also hit the alarm bell button if you wanna get notified when we post new videos. Finally, share in the comments if there's a way to use opposite words that is useful and that you've just figured out in this video, because I wanna know what kinds of things that I'm sharing with you that are new to you that actually help you in your interviews. Any other insights that you got from this video also are appreciated for you to share in the comments, because then I can know what the things that actually work. I hope you've liked this video, and I'll see you in the next one on how to make issue trees from scratch.